Hi, I'm Kate, and on this episode of Bite Scized, we're checking out baking soda. It's probably an ingredient you're already familiar with, but do you actually know what it is? And what recipes you use it in, and why we use it? Or what the difference is between baking soda and baking powder, and when you use one versus the other? We're going to explore all that and more. Chances are, if you've done any baking, you've used baking soda. And that's because its primary function is to have baked goods leaven, which means to rise. We want a cake to be nice, light, and fluffy. And the key behind that is usually baking soda and baking powder. So what's behind the leavening and rising of a baked good? It's gas bubbles. Essentially, the baking soda needs to produce gas bubbles in order for the baked good to rise.
How do we get those gas bubbles? Let's do a quick experiment and put baking soda in water, and then let's put it in vinegar. Which one do we get the gas bubbles in? Well, it's pretty clear, in the vinegar. So the key is an acid. Baking soda needs to react with an acid.
So if you look at any recipe, there's always going to be an acid involved. Sometimes it's a little obvious, like buttermilk, which has a bit of a sourness to it, and other times it's less obvious, like cocoa powder. Either way, the function is the same. They're activating the baking soda. So where does baking powder fit in?
Let's do the same exact experiment. You should see a clear difference. The baking powder reacts with not just the vinegar, but also the water. Why do you think that might be?
Baking powder actually contains baking soda. Additionally, it has two other chemicals, sodium aluminum sulfate and monocalcium phosphate. Now, those sound like a mouthful, but the key is those are acidic. So everything we need for the reaction to occur, both the baking soda and the acidic powders, are all in one can. So why doesn't it react in the can? Well, we have another ingredient, cornstarch, and that acts as a barrier to prevent the reaction from occurring. Additionally, all of those powders need to be in a liquid in order to react.
Liquid isn't the only thing that helps baking powder react. Heat and temperature does too. So here we have hot water, and we can see the baking powder reacts a lot more vigorously in the hot water. When you see on a baking powder double acting, this is what it's talking about. We have one chemical reaction occur when it hits liquid and then another when it hits heat.
All right, let's explain the science. So the key to baking soda, to doing its primary job to make things rise, is that it chemically reacts and undergoes a chemical reaction. Like any chemical reaction, we have reactants, which is what we start with, and products, which is what we end with. We're going to start with what we know and have some gaps, and we'll fill it in over time. So we're going to have baking soda plus some other ingredient, and we know that we end with gas bubbles, which is what causes the baked good to rise. Now let's add molecular names and formulas to show a little bit more of what's going on. Baking soda is technically called sodium bicarbonate and is made up of sodium, hydrogen, carbon, and oxygen. In most recipes, baking soda chemically reacts with some sort of acid or other reactant in the equation. The exact formula of this acid can vary depending on the ingredient, but we'll almost always see a hydrogen atom. For our chemical reaction, we're going to use a common acid found in vinegar, acetic acid, which is made up of hydrogen, carbon, and oxygen. Now there are two other products formed in the chemical reaction, sodium acetate and water. We're not going to go into those too much because they aren't really the key to baking soda's purpose, but it's important to recognize that without them, our reaction wouldn't be balanced. Speaking of balancing, this all gets back to the law of conservation of matter, which says that matter cannot be created or destroyed. So whatever atoms we start with, we'll need to end with. But that's the key about a chemical reaction. The atoms in our starting substances rearrange to create new substances. Essentially, the bonds are broken and the atoms are mixing and mingling to combine in new ways. And these new substances have new properties. They can be different states of matter, look different, and behave differently too. All right, now that we know a little bit of the science, let's get back to our experiment. Today, we're going to be experimenting with pancakes. They're easy, delicious, and because they're not going in the oven, we can see the chemical reaction happening right before our eyes. To get maximum bubbles, we need the optimum chemical reaction to occur between the baking soda and the acidic ingredient in the batter. To do that, we need to think about two things. One, the strength of the acid. The stronger the acid or the acidic ingredient in the batter, the stronger the chemical reaction. And two, it's all about ratios. So we need to think about amounts. Now that does come with some caveats. We can't just keep adding in baking soda because eventually the other ingredients will be a limiting reactant, meaning we need more of those too.
So we made our basic recipe, starting with the dry ingredients, flour, baking powder, the half teaspoon of baking soda, salt, and sugar. Mixed that up and then added in the milk and white vinegar, which is essentially like a homemade buttermilk, as well as an egg, and gave that a real good whisk to make sure everything was fully combined.
Poured that into the pan, literally all of the batter at once into the pan to make a gigantic pancake, which honestly we had some regrets about as we continued to go through trials and could not really flip it. Still, it was delicious, and even though they weren't the prettiest, happy we tried it out. Trial one with our recipe was with half a teaspoon of baking soda. That's what the original recipe called for. The next trial was no baking soda, although it does still have baking powder. We never changed the baking powder throughout the experiment to keep it consistent throughout. Third trial was with 1 teaspoon of baking soda, and the fourth trial was with 2 teaspoons of baking soda. And to be honest, we just got worse and worse at flipping this gigantic pancake. You thought we would learn more, but it just wasn't working despite trying different methods. This was actually the hardest part, and it was a total disaster.
We got this.
Ready? Oh, 3, 2, 1.
No! So our flipping made it a little bit challenging to analyze the color, but we definitely were still able to analyze the fluffiness and texture and taste. So we cut the pancakes in half, gave those a look, and then also gave them a taste test.
Oh, hey, sweetie. There's a good amount of inflation here and fluffiness. This is ideal. So really love the taste of this one. The texture was great. It definitely had that fluffiness to it. It had that buttermilk taste that I look for in a pancake. This was great. Look how much flatter this is. Like, there's almost no give. It's very flat. Definitely not the pancake I want to eat. There's like no texture to it, no fluffiness to it. Doesn't taste that good. Is there too much vinegar in this pancake? Mmm. Wait, that's why I taste the vinegar. I just had an epiphany, which is the fact that this pancake tasted like vinegar, and the reason is because the vinegar didn't react with the baking soda. It had nothing to react to. So there was still like leftover vinegar in the pancake, which is why it tasted off. There's a lot of fluffiness to this. We can see all the bubbles. When we cooked it, we saw tons of bubbles. It's very nice, light, and fluffy. So I actually think this one's pretty good too. I don't think there's a huge difference between pancake, the original recipe, and then doubling the baking soda. And I don't taste the baking soda. So that's good. It's fairly fluffy. Actually, it's very fluffy. Look at that. My guess is that the taste will not be great. We'll definitely taste the baking soda. This one's kind of chewy. Oh, yes. Definitely taste the baking soda. Don't like that. No. So you can definitely taste that there is, yeah, it's like super metallic-y. Ugh, no. The baking soda was definitely left over in this pancake, which meant that there wasn't enough vinegar to react with it. So we'd have to up the amount of vinegar in order to make sure that all the baking soda is used. Like, the baking soda basically isn't being fully used or reacted with. And so we have leftover baking soda, which is definitely not the ideal because then we get that taste.
All right, so we had to squeeze in one last science concept because it was just so noticeable when doing our taste testing. And the concept is limiting reactants. Basically, in a nutshell, it has to do with amounts. A chemical reaction doesn't just tell us what ingredients or compounds are in it, but it also tells us the amounts and gives us clear ratios. So in this example, we need 1 molecule of sodium bicarbonate and 1 molecule of acetic acid to create 1 molecule of carbon dioxide. And if we have too much of one of the reactants, it won't be all the way used because there's not enough of the other reactant to react with it. And that's what happened in the trials where it tasted like baking soda or like vinegar. It was just left over because it couldn't be, quote, used in the chemical reaction. The reactant that there's less of, or basically limits the reaction, is called the limiting reactant.
Final thoughts. I think this shows that baking soda does have a really clear and important function in baked goods and things like pancakes. It's so important to have that nice, light, fluffy texture and to help them leaven. In addition to leavening, though, baking soda has a taste, and it's not a good one. So we need to be careful about how much baking soda we add to make sure that all of it is being used and chemically reacting with the other ingredients in the batter. That will result in the perfect baked good. Thanks for joining us on this episode of Bite Sized. Be sure to like and subscribe for more. Can you imagine trying to take a whole bite? I don't like how it works.